Burnie, on the northwest coast of Tasmania, is the centre of operations of Associated Pulp and Paper Mills Limited, the biggest producers of fine papers in Australia.
The raw material of business, and the stationery store modern office. Our earliest years were interested in picture books, and soon we're learning the three art, where we can begin to record our own ideas upon the paper of exercise books, and are able to experience of learning from the printed word. Our lives will be conducted efficiently only if we can keep a satisfactory record of our income and expenditure upon paper. Until 150 years ago, paper was a rare commodity used only by the wealthy. Our present-day society could never have developed without adequate supplies of paper upon which to record the daily transactions and plans of mankind. For paper helps to spread news and ideas. Paper brings progress. Society, in fact, could not have advanced at such a pace had not a Frenchman, Nicolas Robert, invented the prototype of the modern paper-making machine 150 years ago. Australian timbers rate high amongst the hardwoods of the world, but because they are short-fibred, they were once considered useless for paper-making. The story of paper production from the eucalypt by Associated Pulp and Paper Mills starts in the forests of northwestern Tasmania. The company's forestry experts have surveyed these forests from the air. Aided by stereo photo mosaics, the company prepared maps to show where the road should go to bring suitable stands of timber in reach. When the roads are in, the forests ring to the sound of axe and saw and the crash of falling trees. Time for smoko, and that's just a small part of a morning's work for these Tasmanian forestry men. Timber for production of paper comes from the company's 220,000 acres of freehold forest. Here the company has driven roads worth 100,000 pounds. This timber is supplemented by supplies drawn from Crown land concessions granted by the Tasmanian government. A government which has done everything possible to encourage an industry that is producing great wealth from native forests. Areas that not so long ago produced only small quantities of sawn timber each year and supported just a few hundred head of cattle. The forests are located 20 miles from the coast, and timber jinkers carry loads of logs up to 10 tons in a continuous stream to the mills at Burnie. The logs leave the company's forests on their way to the mills. Thank you. The associated pulp and paper mills are located on the shores of Emu Bay at Burnie, Tasmania. They include the most modern sawmill in the Commonwealth. Logs arriving at this sawmill are handled by a unique skyhook. An operator drives a motorized unit counterbalanced by a huge block of concrete. A high lead is also used to handle the logs. As they arrive at the mill, the logs are measured and tagged. They may be dumped if traffic is heavy. The sky hook suspended high in its counterbalanced cables stacks the logs ready for use. Ordinarily, the high lead is used to remove logs from the jinkers. The logs are transferred to a log deck where they're shortened to mill length. In this moment, they'll be handled entirely by push-button control in the most fully mechanized sawmill in the Southern Hemisphere. Bark is removed from the logs by a hydraulic barker, the only one of its type operating outside North America. A water jet at a pressure of 1,400 pounds per square inch strips the bark like a knife to leave the logs clean and smooth. In the filing room, the bandsaws are maintained. Ribbons of toothed steel to cut the logs into workable sizes on two band mills. Logs up to 5 feet in diameter are put through band mills. Heavy-duty machinery handles the logs by push-button control during their entire passage through the mills. The irregular-shaped timber slabs and the non-commercial grades have been diverted for paper and hard board making. The highest grades are reserved for select milled boards. The sections of commercial grade reach the gang saw and they're soon reduced on this machine to board size. One-inch boards are produced in this mill at the rate of 5,000 superfeet per hour. They are sorted, graded as commercially suitable, and segregated by length. On a stacking machine, the boards are built into seasoning packages, which move through a seasoning cycle of 21 days. The production of these fine hardwood boards, in such demand by the Australian building and furniture industries, is a process that is additional to the main operation of paper making by Associated Pulp and Paper Mills Limited. Paper making requires large quantities of fresh water. At South Burnie, water is readily available from the nearby Emu River. From this river, 14 million gallons are pumped each day to the mills. Power is a further vital requirement. Tasmanian hydroelectricity has attracted many big undertakings to the Apple Isle with its offer of cheap power. Burnie Mill is the biggest consumer of Tasmanian coal, also essential for paper making. So these three items, water, power and coal, come together in these mills at Burnie to help create a huge primary industry that uses as its raw material the natural forests of northwestern Tasmania. The irregular shaped logs, timber waste and grades with no commercial value as timber are fed into a chipper where they're quickly reduced. This is the first of the many processes which will convert timber into high-grade printing and writing papers. The chips are moved on a conveyor belt from the sawmill down to a wood room located midway between the sawmill and the paper mill. To augment the production of chips by the sawmill, timber in the form of billets arrives by rail. These are fed onto a conveyor system which takes them to the woodroom chipper. In the woodroom, chips are screened to limit their size to 1 inch. Larger chips are bypassed through an auxiliary chipper to reduce them, after which they rejoin the mainstream of chips leaving the woodroom. Chips from the sawmill and chips from the reduction of the billets in the woodroom flow on conveyor belts to the paper mill. Here they reach bunkers that feed chips in 10-ton batches into 35 feet high digesters, and the first continuous digester in the southern hemisphere. The huge digesters are virtually pressure cookers. In these digesters, chips are treated with caustic soda made here at the mill and subjected to heat and pressure. Digesters are charged with chips which flow into them from the storage bunkers overhead. The lid is bolted down securely since the pressure in the digester will be considerable during the cooking process. The two important factors involved in the cooking process, pressure and temperature, are charted accurately. When the cook has proceeded for the required period, the charge is blown. This disintegrates the chips, producing a dark brown pulp. Now the pulp passes through three stages of washing, and during all these processes, it is continually examined to produce uniform material. The pulp passes through screens and flows through a multi-stage bleaching plant. Now reaches the target brightness required and is pumped to the beta room for the next stage of preparation. Here, for some qualities, a small percentage of imported pulp is introduced to the eucalypt pulp. In the betas, the pulp is further treated. The last stage in the treatment of the pulp before it reaches the paper-making machines is its passage through refiners, which reduce it to the fine condition needed for the manufacture of high-grade paper. Fine white China clay, rosin, starch, and dyes are blended into a complex mix, which is now ready to feed the paper-making machines. From storage chests, the pulp is fed through fine screens to the head boxes of the machines. Water that has already passed through the paper-making machine is fed back to the pulp to lower its concentration to 1 part of pulp to 200 of water. From the flow boxes, the pulp flows onto a fine endless woven wire screen. The fiber remains as a mat on the continuous wire, the water quickly falling away through the wire. The shaking motion at the wet end of the machine assists to make the mat of uniform texture. Suction boxes assist to remove the large percentage of water carried in the mat on the wire screen. At this point, a dandy roll introduces the watermark or pattern into the wet web of paper. And fine jets of water trim the edges as the wet mat passes them at a speed of up to 700 feet per minute. The paper now leaves the woven bronze wire and is picked up by a woolen felt and squeezed through presses before passing over the drying cylinders. The cylinders, all perfectly smooth, are steam heated. A series of felts hold the paper against the drying rollers as it passes through the machine. Steel calendar stacks impart smoothness and finish. And finally, the paper is wound on reels weighing up to 2 tons. Super-calendared printing paper is processed on a massive machine at high speed under heavy load. This irons the paper, giving the surface a smooth, glossy texture. Reels of paper are made up in readiness for cutting after slitting and winding. On this cutting machine, paper from several reels unwinding together pass under a rotating blade set to cut the sheets to the required length. Circular knives slip the sheets to their correct width. Large quantities of electric power are required to operate a modern paper-making machine and its auxiliary machinery, which in these mills is all electrically driven. The power required would be sufficient to supply a fair-sized city. Power drawn from the state hydroelectric supply by the mill is supplemented by the output of turbo alternators driven by steam generated within the plant. The high-pressure steam passes through the turbines and comes out as low-pressure steam used in the drying cylinders. The work of maintaining all this electrical machinery ensures the uninterrupted flow of paper through the machines for the 24 hours of each day. Electrical maintenance includes armature winding and the development, construction and installation of new equipment. Mechanical maintenance of the plant demands the services of a big staff of engineers. Chipper blades must be resharpened after 8 hours' use. In this engineering shop, machinery is repaired and maintained and new equipment and fittings are fabricated. Many Burnie women are employed in the finishing rooms of the mills. Finishing starts at the cutters with a selection of reels to comprise a set that will give uniformity of smoothness and shade in the stacks of sheeted paper. The finishing room is located above the main cutting and maturing plant level. Each section of this department comprises 12 sorters, one counter, a paper distributor and 2 wrappers. Every sheet of paper is inspected. The slightest flaw will result in immediate rejection. This is handwork which cannot be carried out by any machine yet developed. The counters become so expert that they can count a ream of 500 sheets in less than a minute. The reams of sorted paper are carefully packed so they'll reach the printer in perfect condition. Package reams are made up into bales, and Burnie board, made in this integrated group of mills, completes the pack which is then bound with wire. There's no better bale pack in the world. The paper's also supplied in reels, and these are carefully packed in heavy craft paper to avoid damage during handling. Patented steel bands are an important feature in the packaging of reels of Burnie paper. The bands protect the reels against the possibility of the damage if the reel is dropped. Papermaking is a manufacturing art with many varying factors. Scientific control over the raw materials of papermaking reduces the variation of these factors to a minimum. Without such control, papermaking would be a hazardous business with little guarantee of consistent results. Quality control is carried out constantly during production by a special staff that checks the product as it leaves the machines. Paper is tested for its tensile strength, its opacity, its bursting strength and its thickness. The economics of paper making are carefully balanced and are bound up with the efficient application of the many chemical processes involved. Without the efficient manufacture of chemicals and their recovery, the industry would find it difficult to produce reasonably priced paper. Caustic soda is recovered by burning the black liquor after the pulp has been removed, following the cooking and washing processes. The liquor burns vigorously in rotary furnaces, leaving ordinary washing soda as a residue. From this is recovered a large percentage of the soda used in the process of pulp making. Heat from these furnaces supplements that provided by burning coal and timber waste for the production of steam. The water in the liquor passes to the stacks that are such a distinguishing feature of the landscape at South Burnie. The chemicals, caustic soda and chlorine, are produced in this electrolytic cell room from purified salt brine solution in the presence of quicksilver. The mercury used in this plant is valued at more than 100,000 pounds. Associated pulp and papers have developed from small beginnings in 1936. Since that time, Burnie has expanded from a community relying upon a comparatively small income from timber getting, grazing and potato growing, into a large-sized town. Burnie maintains a deep water port with accommodation for ocean-going ships. From this port are shipped more than 50,000 tons of paper products each year. The town of Burnie has become prosperous, maintaining big stores filled with all the essentials and luxuries for comfortable living. The mills employ more than 2,000 Burnie citizens. Their income from their work of timber, paper and hardboard manufacture exceeds £1.5 million each year. With the ever-expanding need for more and more paper, the sound development of this great industry has given the people of Burnie a security often lacking in other towns. So they feel that they can safely afford many of the amenities that assist in achieving the good life. The security enjoyed by those employed by the mills extends beyond their regular employment. Modern cottages nestle on the hills rising from the coast at Burnie. The company has made it possible for employees the construction of small homes which will become their very own. The terms available are most favourable, and security of employment, good wages and a home of one's own has found for many a contentment that tends to become more and more elusive in our big cities. The opportunities here at Burnie, on the beautiful northwest coast of Tasmania, have attracted many people from the mainland who've settled down to raise their families under ideal conditions here. Yes, Burnie's a busy town with an ever-increasing population. Healthy young Australians are raised in ideal surroundings that make for a good start in life. Burnie's General Hospital is having trouble in coping with the large number of her newer citizens who are constantly arriving. Dad recovers from his ordeal with a round of 18 holes on one of Tasmania's many beautiful golf courses. Burnie's a sport-loving town, and basketball is popular with the girls. If that's a little too strenuous, then one can play bowls on perfect greens. Australian rules is the most popular football game here, drawing big crowds. The town has fine beaches and saltwater pools which attract many visitors from the mainland. 2 miles from Burnie, and we can walk through country that is reminiscent of England's green fields and valleys. The Emu River and other streams nearby provide good sport for the angler. Ten o'clock closing here, and 7 hotels to take care of Burnie citizens and busy tourist trade. Although the primary aim of associated pulp and paper mills was originally to produce high-grade paper, the processing of the by-products of papermaking has reached important proportions. Burnie board, our pressed hardboard, has become a major product. Mill waste from all the sawmills of northwestern Tasmania was formerly of no commercial use. It has now become part of the valuable raw material from which Burnie board is processed. Timber billets, which have no commercial value as timber, also arrive at the Burnie board mill. Here, with the mill waste, they are chipped as the first part of a process that will reduce the timber to fibrous pulp from which the hardboard is made. The chips reach storage bunkers which provide a reservoir of raw material for the continuous round-the-clock operation of the mill. The chips are reduced to pulp and defibrators by the grinding action between the serrated discs rotating at high speed. Large quantities of water are also used in this process to hold the defibrated timber in suspension. The pulp is screened to remove oversized material and is then washed in the same manner as we've seen for paper making. Waterproofing size and chemicals are added to the pulp, which now passes to the forming machine. This machine is similar in the principle of its operation to the wet end of a paper-making machine. The stock flows onto a forming wire, which carries the mixture of pulp and water slowly forward. The mixture is retained at the edge of the wire by rubber belts. A puddling action consolidates the pulp. Water falls away through the continuous wire screen. A fibrous mat or wet lap, several inches in thickness, has been formed. It moves forward in a continuous sheet through rolls that remove much of the remaining water content and reduce its thickness. The wet lap continues its course through press rolls and more water falls away. Saws continuously trim the edges of the mat as it emerges from the machine. A diagonal saw cuts the material into lengths as it moves forward. The machine is completely automatic throughout the cycle of its operation. The wet lap sections are loaded into racks and pressed against stainless steel plates in a hydraulic press that exerts a force of 4,000 tons. The remaining moisture is forced from the material and passes through the mill stack. The fiber mat, under the influence of heat and pressure, has become a hard board with a thickness of 3/16 of an inch. After passing through humidifying treatments, the processing of Burnie board is completed. This mill has converted materials formerly wasted into a high-quality product, much sought after by architects, building contractors and handymen. Burnie board is packaged using timber packs made on the spot from Burnie timber. Some of the board is cut to many different sizes in the mill for use in packaging bales of Burnie printing and writing papers. An amenities block provides dental services for all employees of the Burnie Mills. Employees and their families are assisted too with medical and optical treatment. Every amenity for comfortable employment has been introduced. Within the block you'll find the company's safety officer, whose role is to track down every situation which may contribute towards an accident. He's introduced steel helmets, which have prevented several injuries, and steel toe caps to protect the feet. First aid experts stand by during all shifts, ready to give immediate assistance should it be required. The company employs a counsellor to assist employees who may have financial problems, sickness in the home, or just plain hard luck. Here he is arranging for a man to get assistance for his wife who's not well and needs help with the kiddies. As a result, pay is not lost through absence from the job. The youngest kiddie is taken care of and the older ones go off to school as usual. In the evening, children of employees attend gymnasium in the amenities block building. They're a healthy bunch of youngsters bubbling over with high spirits. Upstairs in the amenities block, there are dancers in a well-equipped hall. These evenings give employees and their families a chance to get together and really enjoy themselves. Burnie Mills comprise an integrated industry, a series of industries based on the use of the same raw material. Papermakers Limited is located here, and this subsidiary company produces vegetable parchment for butter wraps, greaseproof paper and glassine. Large quantities of imported pulp made from softwoods are used in this mill. In a hydropulper, eucalypt pulp and imported pulp are mixed to produce many of the special grades of papers made here. paper-making process in this mill follows upon the same methods which we've already seen. The pulp passes through beaters and refiners before reaching the paper-making machines. Here, a wide variety of papers is produced, including most of the fine writing papers used in Australia. Glycine is made in many colours and is used for bag making and confectionery packing. From this mill come tinted banks, bonds, system boards and pages. There's a fascination in watching these machines as they produce mile upon mile of paper for the 24 hours of each day and for 48 weeks of each year. On this machine, greaseproof paper is converted into transparent glycine as a result of pressure and the friction of polishing rollers. Paper from the Burnie Mill is converted into vegetable parchment on a parchmentizing machine. The base paper is gelatinized by the effect of strong sulfuric acid. After passing through the acid treatment and the washing and drying processes, the parchmentized paper is used mainly to wrap Australia's butter. Other forms of the parchment are used in teleprinters and for greeting cards. Paper is cut and embossed on other machines to produce the many forms so well known to Australian paper users. Parchment residues are shredded here. They're used in packing biscuits and sweets. The offices of the parent company deal with figures that are astonishing. The annual value of the output of the company and its subsidiaries is nearly £10 million, and 50,000 tons of paper are shipped each year to different parts of Australia and New Zealand. It requires a big staff of office personnel to handle the accounting for such a great enterprise as this. The operation of a £10 million investment calls for the highest degree of efficiency in office organisation, and this has been achieved here at Burnie. Seasoned timber bearing the now famous Burnie label is packed in readiness for shipping. Burnie board is stacked at the wharves ready to be loaded into ships which will take it to the mainland. The well-packed bales of Burnie paper too are loaded at this busy port. Many shipments of these reels of paper are sent to a subsidiary company, Ballarat Paper Mills in Victoria. Here they are converted by this company's coating plant to special high-gloss art papers for printing and packaging, marketed under the Ballarat label. The integrated group of mills relies mainly upon the 220,000 acres of freehold forest for the continued supply of raw material. So valuable are these forests that their protection against fire is of prime importance. The company's forest vehicles are all equipped with radio communication as part of a fire watching system during danger periods. The entire future of this great paper-making enterprise depends upon the continuous growth of new trees. This is encouraged by removing the unwanted undergrowth that would prevent young eucalypts from establishing themselves. It'd be fatal if fire should sweep through the new growth of young eucalypt trees. Large areas of land denuded of forest by the early settlers are being planted with Pinus radiata. As winter begins, thousands of seedlings are planted using a combined grading and planting machine. Pinus radiata grows well in this district, where the annual rainfall approaches 90 inches. These trees will one day reduce the quantity of imported pulps needed by the mills. Logging's a year-round operation, and with the heavy winter rains, the difficulties of getting timber out of the forests are increased. Now's the time for the roads, which have served during the summer season, to be surfaced for all weather use. Stone is crushed on the spot in mobile crushers, and gravel is taken from deposits nearest to where it's required. Logs can thus continue to be brought to the mills throughout wettest periods of the year. The bulk of the timber used in the mills comes from the eucalypts, but the company's research department is constantly at work to develop methods of handling other species of trees, particularly the myrtle beech, which is a common species in northwestern Tasmania. The established processes are constantly being reviewed and improved as the company's industrial chemists produce new facts resulting from their research. Research has already played a most important role in the creation of this great enterprise. The department prepares the plans for the continued development and expansion of the company's activities in Tasmania. These plans are being made with a sure knowledge that the company's employees will be right behind all moves for improvement within the plant. The Papermakers' Council is an organization constituted to cooperate with the company in establishing, developing, and administering mutual plans for the collective and individual benefit of employees. The forests of northwestern Tasmania have become a perennial crop to be harvested in perpetuity. Great areas are being established after more than 100 years of forest management. This will protect the watersheds and preserve the natural supply from the Emu River. 50 years from now, as a result of the Burnie program, more timber will be available than is the case today. That is progress in the truest sense. Successful research, backed by the faith of those who had the courage and the skill of Australians, has produced one of the Commonwealth's greatest and most efficient industries. There is nothing better of its kind in the world.